Hello, good morning. Can you hear me? Hello, good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Ramadishna, you are online.
Are we online?
Yes, start, please.
Okay, very good morning to all of you. And, you know, we have had a wonderful day one, and look forward to having a very successful day two. For today, we have, you know, a couple of sessions. The first session is going to be on market deployment of biomethane, and there is going to be a keynote followed by a panel discussion. And then we have a session on commercialization of cellulosic ethanol. And there we have a keynote, and then followed by a panel discussion. So we do have Kyriakos here. Kyriakos, you would like to make the opening statement?
Yes, I mean, yesterday was a very nice, very interesting opening session, and the session following on SAF, sustainable aviation fuels, it went very well, very good presentations. All the speakers spoke very well. They answered the questions. They kept the time, which is extremely important, and I hope that we're going to have exactly the same thing today. So I'm looking forward to the day of today. And without any more delay, I would suggest that we start immediately so that we're going to gain a few minutes. Our first speaker is a keynote presentation from Verbio, Klaus Sauter. As you know, Verbio is one of our platinum sponsors. It's a very big company with doing an amazing work on various areas, with, of course, specializing in biomethane. And, of course, they're expanding to other areas like biomethane and so on. So I'm not going to take any more of your time. I now leave the floor to Klaus Sauter and Ashish Kumar, who is more or less the CEO of Verbio in India. You have the floor, Klaus and Ashish.
You need to unmute.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Right.
Good morning, gentlemen. Good morning, Kyriakos. Pleasure to see you again. I think the first time we met 20, 25 years ago.
Something like that, yeah.
So, yeah. Constantly, the roads are always crossing, so the family is not big. So I have a presentation, and wait, okay, I think I can join my screen here. Okay. So can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes? Yes. Welcome to the green zone. Okay, 15 minutes. Kyriakos told us that we should stay in time, and this is something what we will do and follow. So the first question is who we are. Who is Verbio? Verbio is biofuel and technology. So we are a pure biofuel game. Verbio is a listed company. We do beyond 1 billion euro revenue. We will have a very successful year this year with an EBITDA of 300 million euro. 820 employees, mainly German-based, but we are going to expand. And we have a market share overall in Germany by 20%. Finally, we are the world's largest biomethane producer, or renewable natural gas, how they call it in the US, from agriculture residues. And to make a long story short, but I will come later on, we decided to make CH4. We had decided to make renewable natural gas from cellulose and hemicellulose, and not to make cellulosic ethanol. So today we have production capacity for biodiesel, for bioethanol, and for Verbio gas, renewable natural gas. So we are doing all the the main biofuels. This is our board. We are working together many, many years. And we are reporting on an EBITDA margin. So what you can see here, the green is the amount of liquid biofuels. And yellow is the amount of gaseous. This is our renewable natural gas. And here you can see that finally, yeah, the liquid biofuels, biodiesel, bioethanol, are becoming mature. There is not very much space to increase either in Europe nor in the United States. But what is growing is renewable natural gas, and this development will accelerate in the next years. Since 2017, we were a pure German game, only production capacity in Germany. And because Europe was reluctant, the target for 2020 to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in transport was 5%. So 95% emissions in transport were okay. So that was the reason that we said, well, we are not able to grow because the market is not growing. The ambitions are not growing. And that was the reason why we went to the United States, or let's say North America. We have one biodiesel plant in Canada, and we bought a cellulosic ethanol plant from DuPont. DuPont built in Iowa a cellulosic ethanol plant. They wanted to make ethanol from corn stover, but unfortunately it didn't work. So we bought this site in 2017, and we transfer it right now to our biorefinery. The first production of cellulosic renewable natural gas started in December 2021. And on the other side, we went to India. Our focus was to go somewhere in tropical and subtropical areas. And we ended up in India, where is plenty of biomass available. But this later on, Ashish will tell you what is our clear project there in India. So what are we doing? My background is I'm farmer's son. And our strategic approach is that agriculture is the new upstream. For us, it is the new upstream. Our ambition is that we want to be able, or that we are able, to transform everything the global farmer can supply us into some molecules. Let's call it biomass molecules. From the oil seeds, sunflower, rape, soy, we are going to make rapeseed methyl ester. A big complicated molecule. There is carbon, there is hydrogen, there is oxygen. On the grain side, we are able to use any kind of grain, and we are going to make alcohol, ethanol. And with the residues from our first two processes, plus chicken manure, plus straw, anything what is biomass and what is coming from agriculture, we make renewable natural gas, CH4. So these are our three molecules, and I call it, this is the first stage of going from biomass to something what you can use. What you can use in transport as a biofuel or for chemical applications. This is our approach. So we are open to do anything. Today we are selling these molecules into the transport because there we have a business case. So our FAME, our rapeseed methyl ester, has nothing to do with diesel, but it goes as a blending component into the diesel segment. Ethanol has nothing to do with gasoline, but it's possible to blend into gasoline. And CH4, methane, is the smallest hydrocarbon. It's, let's say, he has fossil brothers. So finally, with CH4, you can do everything. So this is our approach. And how does this look like? I have some pictures. So this was our first facility. This is our biodiesel and glycerine production in Germany. And here, as you can see, over the years, we developed further products. So we are not only making the rapeseed methyl ester, we are one of the biggest pharmaceutical glycerine, high-grade glycerine producer in Europe, which goes to pharmaceutical and chemical applications. We developed a process to take phytosterol out of the vegetable oil, out of the rapeseed oil. And in 2017, we didn't produce it. And today we are world market leader for phytosterol. This is our flagship. This is our biorefinery. It's located inside a mineral oil refinery. It is, let's say the green heart of the refinery. And at this location, we are doing exactly what I described you, theoretically. Here we do it in practical. At this location, we can transfer everything the global farmer supplies us to biomass molecules. And the biodiesel goes as a blending component for diesel into the refinery. The bioethanol the same way, and all the renewable natural gas is injected into the natural gas grid. And as another co-product, we have here bio fertilizer. So we are producing ammonium sulfur solution, and this goes back to agriculture. So a very nice circle. This is our site in Germany. This is, let's say, the blueprint for our investment in India. This is 20 megawatt biomethane production only from straw. And in Europe, we use grain straw, rye, barley, wheat. In the United States, we use corn stover. And in India, we use paddy, which is rye straw, and also some wheat straw. And this here on the picture, number 13, this is our production site in Nevada, Iowa. This is the cellulosic ethanol plant, what I mentioned from DuPont. So you can see here on the left that we built here, 13 digesters, these big tanks on the left. And it will end up with 16. And then we will have there 80 megawatt of RNG production. And as I said, this is our biorefinery concept. Corn goes in. We are going to produce traditional ethanol. Then from the stillage, we are not making feed. The stillage goes to RNG production. And on top, we are also using about 100,000 tons of corn stover, corn straw, which goes into this RNG production. So we will be able to produce there at this location cellulosic RNG, then residual RNG, and traditional corn ethanol. Maybe what I want to add here is that the biofuel production is always very much linked to the local regulation. So the regulation in the United States is completely different from what we have here in Europe. But anyway, also the focus is to grow in cellulosic biofuels. And our process to make renewable natural gas for transport is very efficient. We need 4 balls of straw. to produce enough RNG to run a mid-class car 1 year. It took us a long time, but it's a very efficient process. Now let's come, and I have just a few minutes left, about the regulation, which is super important. Finally, Europe has clear ambitions. We are going to drive down the CO2 emissions by 55% until 2030. And this is a huge challenge. And at the beginning, I mentioned that in 2020, the greenhouse gas obligation, the obligation to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in transport was just 5%. And to translate Fit for 55 into national legislation, you can see on the left. The obligation will now increase from 5% in 2020 to 25% in 2030. This is a huge ambition. And the first generation of biofuels are limited. So the growth will come from advanced biofuels Annex 9. So what is Annex 9 and what is advanced biofuel? So Annex 9 is a feedstock list. Feedstocks for the production of biogas for transport and advanced biofuel. It's a feedstock list. But most of these feedstocks on the list, 90%, are feedstocks for anaerobic digestion, are feedstocks for renewable natural gas. So, and this is the reason why we decided to go for renewable natural gas. It's a robust process, and you are not dependent on one feedstock. What is something completely new is RevenBo, where we also want to go. What is RevenBo? RevenBo is renewable fuels, non-biologic origin. If you look here, and this is based off 1 ton of straw, which goes to our anaerobic digestion. So if we give there in 1 ton of straw, then we are producing about 208 cubic meters of, let's call it straw gas, and 315 kilogram of CO2. This is what is happening from 1 ton of straw. The lignin as a fertilizer goes back to agriculture, but this is not my focus at the moment. So 208 norm cubic meters is the equivalent of 210 liters of diesel. So if we are going now and take renewable electricity, make hydrogen and oxygen, and combine it with the CO2 from our digesters, we developed a reactor where we put the CO2 from our anaerobic digestion in, plus renewable hydrogen, and then we are going to produce another amount of CH4. Again, it's the same molecule. And just to give you a feeling, this 315 kilogram of CO2 will create 114 kilogram of CH4, which is another 160 liter of diesel equivalent. So finally, in this combination, you can increase the yields from the biomass production significantly in the combination with renewable electricity. This is our biorefinery concept. To make just one thing doesn't make really sin. You have to combine it. So what is natural gas? It's called natural gas methane CH4. So CH4, natural gas, if it's coming from Putin here in Germany, then it's fossil. If we have a digester and we give in there mice, then we have the first generation biofuel, but again, it's CH4. If we put in the digester straw or chicken manure, we have second generation biofuel. It's renewable natural gas, but it's still CH4. And if we combine the CO2 with renewable electricity, we call it synfuel, but it's still CH4. So you can see, it's always the same molecule. All the infrastructure, piping, cleaning, transport, storage, filling station, end user, maybe trucks, maybe chemistry. It's all the same. And this is the huge advantage from CH4. Because of this, we decided not to go to cellulosic ethanol. So what is the consequence? Verbio started phase one. We are going to invest in the phase one, 400 million euro in capacity expansion in Europe and North America until 2023. This is mainly expansion of our production site in Germany and in the United States. We are also going to go more downstream. Bio-LNG is an argument. Right now, it's mainly CNG, how we bring it to transport. But for Europe, it is clear LNG. So we are going to cool the methane down and make bio-LNG. And we are going to chemistry. Next application, as I said, we have biomass molecules. And we develop new processes to enter into a renewable and sustainable chemistry. So thank you very much. Last sentence. I mentioned that the investments, mainly what we are doing, are in Europe and in North America. I didn't say something about India. This is the main part from Ashish. But India has huge opportunities and great possibilities, especially to increase the amount of advanced molecules. But the regulation is, let's say, not there or not in the right way. And this is something, I don't know who is joining this meeting, this is something what we have to develop in the time coming. Because there are a lot of possibilities, but we cannot continue to invest, we cannot increase our capacities if we have not a real business case. So thank you very much for your attention. And now I hand over to my colleague, Ashish Kumar. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Klaus. Okay, let's get started with India. I'm just going to upload my presentation. I hope it's visible.
Yeah, I can see.
Okay, so let's try and understand what are we doing in India now. So first of all, let's address a couple of questions. Why are we really discussing about biomethane in the Indian context? I mean, is it going to really contribute in solving the air pollution crisis which India has at the moment, or is it more of a seasonal phenomena, which is normally criticized in Delhi around Diwali and then very conveniently forgotten by Christmas? Do we really have biomethanation technologies which are implemented at an industrial scale yet? And finally, as Klaus said, I mean, we need to have a strong business case, a sustainable one. So is there a significant market potential for the products, the CBG as well as biomanure? Now, let's try and address these topics step by step. To start off with, I think we are familiar with the import dependency India has on the crude oil. 87% of our crude oil demand is imported. So there is clearly a demand to find alternative local fuels over here. And on the other hand, when we look purely from an agri point of view, there is abundance of agri residue which is available. In 2021, last year, India generated about 700 million metric tons of agri residue. And this has been growing at a pretty more than a moderate rate. And just to give you an impression of where, what is the regional clusters which is generating this kind of agri residue, you see it's primarily dominated by the northern region and also certain states on the western, southwestern part. It gives you an impression of the volume of the residue we are talking about, which is generated almost all over the country, quite uniformly. But what are we doing with this residue? This is what we are normally familiar with. Every year, almost 65% of the surplus agri residue is burnt, which in turn generates millions of tons of greenhouse gases. This is what is the status quo at the moment with this supply of agri residue we have, which ultimately leads to a poor air quality. This is just to give you an impression of what is the air quality index in a, let's say, one of the stations in Delhi. So in a year, let's say we are talking about 4 months out of the 12 months where we are breathing poor, very poor, or a severe quality of air. Now, this definitely is something which has a huge impact on the healthcare as well. And just to give you an idea, India has a share of almost 32% of the global respiratory diseases, and air pollution is clearly one of the biggest contributors. So this definitely needs to be attended. This is what we end up seeing during the typical harvest months of paddy in the period of October, November. This is what, you know, we read in the newspapers. There is also some sarcasm around it. It has definitely raised attention at the highest levels. But unfortunately, there is still a very limited success which has been achieved so far. So what are we doing? I mean, Klaus already talked about, do we have the technology? Yes, Verbio is the technology leader when it comes to straw to biogas. We already have industrial scale units which are running in Germany for more than 7 years now. We commissioned a plant in Iowa, and we are getting ready to commission the plant in Punjab as well. So what are we doing in Punjab? This is how the plant looks like. This will be India's largest biomethanation capacity with 33 tons of bio-CNG production, as well as more than 500 tons of biomanure production per day. We plan to commission the plant in the next 3 to 4 weeks. So Q1 is what we are looking at. And this unit will consume about 100,000 tons of straw per year. And how this has been implemented, this is what we are doing at the ground level. This is who we are, and this is what we are trying to make a change in the state of Punjab. And this is all done by our own investment. This is a fully integrated straw supply chain, which has been implemented by us with our own machinery, with our own trained labor. There is not a third party involved in any of these aggregation mechanisms. This is how the entire supply chain for the aggregation of the feedstock, which is supposed to be one of the biggest challenges, this is how we are doing it. Of course, it has taken us more than 2 years to implement this level of accuracy. We are still not perfect, but it is definitely getting better every day. And this does not come without the support of the local farmers. So, till date, there is not a single market player or an aggregator which could deliver the straw for the expected price or the quality. And therefore, we invested on our own and built this entire setup. This is what we are doing with the stubble, which is normally getting burnt. So we are protecting it because, of course, this needs to be fed into our fermenters. So there is 100% in-house management and investment right from the collection, transportation, storage, protection. The complete cost and quality control is managed by us in-house. Also, the end product transportation, we have our own, we have built our own fleet of trucks and cascades wherein the end product, the CBG, will be transported to IOCL retail outlets, who is our offtake partner. We have a commercial agreement with Indian Oil. 18 retail outlets have been lined up. And as we speak, we are also in the process of finalizing industrial as well as commercial consumers. As Klaus said, I mean, I would ideally want to replace this Volkswagen with a Maruti Suzuki in the next couple of months. And I would ideally want to switch the narrative from, we need to bring in the narrative of B-mobility, the biofuel mobility over here. The four straws which we are talking about here, yes, they will not look rectangular here. They will be more cylindrical over here in Indian context. But yes, they will also make the local, it'll make the fuel for the local transportation. And finally, in terms of the market potential, what we talked about, we are talking about 700 million metric tons of agri residue getting generated, of which 200 million metric tons is surplus. And unfortunately, 65% of that is getting burned. Now that leads to an opportunity of more than 20 million tons of CBG production on an annual basis. And this is purely coming from agri residue only. So what do we need? In addition to that, the market opportunity, we also need to, we did some internal assessment. And what we realized is with the investment Verbio has made in Punjab, which is roughly about 25 million euros, that's 100% equity. There is no debt component in it. This leads to an external economic return of a factor of almost 8 to 9 times. It goes back to the society, to the government, to the environment in terms of reduction of air pollution, in the form of savings of forex, creating employment, farmer income, as well as reducing the healthcare costs, taxation, substitution of fertilizer in the form of subsidy reduction. So this is what Verbio is bringing back in addition to the investment it makes. So there is clearly a relevant case for biomethane in India. We need investments and not just LOIs. They are the true indicators. There are proven biomethanation technologies which exist. First successes have already been achieved when it comes to implementing an effective supply chain. The initial startup policy, as well as the support from the OMCs, has been extremely encouraging. But we need to move, as we say in the biofuel world, from first generation to second generation of policy push. We need it to establish a more bankable and economically viable business case so that there is a sustainable business case of CBG in India. And just to give you an overview of what is the kind of, let's say, push or the levers we are looking at. Financial, whether it is talking about reinstating the CFA or very important to get low-cost financing. Secondly, would be to ensure the feedstock automation and supply chain facilitation. We do not really talk much about biomanure over here. This, again, is as important as the offtake of the CBG. We need to ensure policies related to the grid connectivity. The commercial terms and conditions still have some room for improvement. There is a scope for optimization for the commercial terms as well. And yes, there has to be a push in the initial stage, like any other industry would need, some provisions from the government, central as well as state, wherein the demand can be created. We need a strong government support for the first 100 industrial scale bio-CNG projects in the country so that a solid foothold can be established for this industry. And if these are the measures getting implemented over the next couple of months or years, there is a solid case, and not only Verbio, but you will have a lot other investors moving into the market. But to conclude, with these policies in place, Verbio definitely proposes a strong commitment to the local Indian market. And how do we do that? We are looking at setting up 50 to 60 large industrial scale units until 2030, wherein the phase one could be about 10 units. We have already identified locations in the northern part of India. These can be implemented within the next 3 years, followed by a multiplication of additional 50 units over the next 5 years. This will lead to a capacity of 700,000 tons of annual bio-CNG production, which can be actually optimized up to close to a million plus capacity. This will lead to a consumption of about 6 to 7 million tons of straw, which can be consumed. And to get started, this phase one of 10 CBG units, this is what we are working towards at the moment, has an investment demand of 200 million euros. So this is what Verbio is doing in India. I hope these inputs are getting registered, and also that Verbio is committed to the Indian market, and we would really jointly work together with all the stakeholders to make this happen. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Klaus and Ashish, for the very nice and excellent, very clear presentation. You know, Klaus, I've been following the development of Verbio through the years, and sometimes specifically when you bought the DuPont plant in the US, I would say, what is going on? Where is Verbio going? But now I see the strategic investment that you have done in the US. You were able to keep the presentation on time, so we have time for two questions. Ernesto, can we have the first one, please? Klaus.
Yes. Case, what you did. Well, no, we have no experience with algae oil. As I said, I know these developments and this let's say stories about algae, but finally, you know, we take what the global agriculture supplies us. So if there is somebody who is able to do algae oil on a competitive price, because at the end of the day, it's business. So at a competitive price, then I think we can try and look what it is. Verbio has still, you know, we are a listed company, but we have still this German Mittelstand view. So we take risk. We don't have to. We don't have a very long decision line. So we are entrepreneurial. We are fast. We take risks. And if algae will come up, but finally, I don't believe it's coming up. It's too expensive, too complicated. And at the moment, it's nothing what we have on the radar.
Okay, thank you, Klaus. Ernesto, can we go on with the question? Well, let's keep that one. It was answered more or less. Let's go to the question by Aaron P.I.
Well, this is a very interesting question, why we should use hydrogen for making synfuel. The very simple question. Take Germany. We are one of the biggest industrial countries in the world. But we had a lot of people. And we have not enough land. So finally, there is the demand of energy in our country, in Germany. But there are not enough possibilities. So the point is that we have to bring, and this is what we are doing right now also as a society. We take crude oil from the Middle East or from Russia or from somewhere else, and we bring it to the industrial hubs. And the same is what is our thinking. So look on the Midwest of the United States. There is plenty of land available, but there are no people. And there are 200 ethanol plants in the Midwest of the United States. So our clear focus is to use these possibilities there in the Midwest and to be able to have cheap renewable electricity, but there is no demand. Now, the idea is how we can use this local advantage and bring the energy where it is needed. And this is synfuel. It's nothing else or nothing more than the ability to make local, cheap, renewable electricity transportable. This is the idea. And by the way, this is exactly now happening everywhere. I had a very interesting meeting this week. So also what is going on in the Middle East, there are big projects with solar energy. I tell you, the desert is becoming an asset. The desert is becoming an asset to use the possibilities. But I think the ability to have their super cheap energy will not lead that we will see in the desert big factories, because nobody wants to go there. Nobody wants to work there. So we have to find a way to use these assets and to bring these energy to the locations where it is needed. And it's just a question, what will be the cheapest way to ensure this transport? Some people talk about methanol. Some people talk about ammonium. We say it is CH4 because we made good experience with CH4 and we developed technologies. Finally, it is open. What is the cheapest way to do it? We'll win. But I think we were quite successful the last 20 years in assumptions, how the market will develop, where it will go. And this is exactly the point. We are using our CO2. We are using local abilities to make cheap renewable electricity and bring the energy where it is needed. Finally, the same structure we can also do in India. For example, also this I want to mention, why we went to India, because there is a lot of biomass, unused biomass, which is harming at the moment the local situation. So let's see where are the advantages from each location on this planet. And our focus is, yeah, to be able to make biomass molecules at the moment, mainly for transport, but also for other applications.
Thank you. I will still allow one short question, and this is going to be for Aziz. Can we have the question from Hinderer, please? Ernesto. Okay, I will read it. The question is, little practical question, why are you using round bales in India instead of square bales?
We started with the square bales, and the typical Indian square bales are about 20 kilograms, right? And that is because of the reason that we do not have locally manufactured balers available, right? So the balers which are locally available give us 20 kilogram of bales. We did that in the first year, that was in 2019, and we realized what not to do, because if we have to collect 100,000 tons of feedstock every year, this is a huge manpower management exercise. So we definitely needed a much bigger form of bale. So we moved into the round bales. Now, we had an option to switch over to the square bales as well, as we do in Germany, but it was purely a cost decision, because we are talking about the round balers, which still need to be imported, but from a costing, from a capex point of view, they are much more effective from an investment standpoint. So we moved into round bales first, which gave us about 250 kilograms. We got 250 kilograms of bales in the previous year, and now we are using bales which go up to almost 450 kilograms, which is almost the same volume what we get from the square bales. So the efficiency is achieved at a much better cost proposition. That's why we are still going with the round bales.
Thank you, Aziz. So I abused a little bit my prerogative of co-chairing this session, and I took away 3 minutes from the panel discussion. The panel discussion is going to be with Arthur Wellinger from EEE&M as the moderator. Arthur, you have the floor from now on. It's at your hands.
Thank you, Kyriakos. Thank you for the introduction. I have the honor to moderate this panel, which is certainly an interesting part with excellent panelists. The goal for me, my personal goal of today's discussion, is that we want to have a decent information exchange that started already, by the way, and we want to continue and go into more details. And we want to learn from each other, and that's the ultimate goal. But therefore, we should also discuss some of the bottlenecks we are facing. So this is the target. And of course, we want to compare situations in Europe and India and elsewhere in Asia to make sure that we have a decent exchange. I'm very happy to present to you the panelists. We have already seen and heard Klaus Sauter, CEO of Verbio and founder, by the way. Ashish Kumar, who is the managing director of Verbio in India. We will have some Naranjan, I don't know how to spell it properly, sorry. He is co-founder of the Carbon Masters, a climate tech company, who is launching an RNG brand, actually, which is the interesting part. We will have Uwe Fritsche from Germany, from INES, an international operating institute on sustainability. And we have Shivangi Tiwari, who is a manager at Invest India, in the oil and gas team. And last but not least, we have Sharad Mittal from Low Carbon Fuels Asia, a company of Shell. So, introducing these guys is at the same time opening the discussion. I would suggest that we first give the floor to Uwe Fritsche, because he's finishing right now a little publication, an overview on the biomethane production throughout the world on behalf of IEA Bioenergy. And this might open our angle a little bit beyond India and Europe. So I would like to give the floor to Uwe, please.
Thank you, Arthur, and good morning, everyone from Germany in Europe. As Art said, we are in the moment finalizing an intertask project which looks to renewable gases in general, and biomethane has a near to middle term focus. And just to give you the perspective, you may have heard yesterday in the opening Paolo Frankl from the International Energy Agency talking about advanced biofuels, and the IEA is also looking very deeply into biomethane and in its net zero emission scenarios for 2050, the role of renewable gases in the overall global gas grids is about a third. So 35% of gases being used in grids in 2050 are supposed to be renewable. And of that, the majority comes from biomethane. About 20% of all natural gas consumed globally by 2050 will be biomethane under that decarbonization logic. Now, if we look to the major producers and potentials around the planet, clearly there's Europe. We have already started more than 30 years ago with biomethane. Nowadays, we are producing something like 200 terawatt hours of biomethane, and we have a potential by 2050 between 1,000 and 1,500 terawatt hours. So we can go up five times at least the current production. The next big player on the globe is China, which in the moment produce something in the order of 100 terawatt hours. And it has a target to double that by 2030. So going up to 200 terawatt hours of biomethane. In the United States, currently, there is about 20 terawatt hours of biomethane being produced. But again, the growth there is rather rapid. And we heard already about renewable natural gas in transport. This is a major issue in the United States for trucks, but also for cars. And we're going to see more biomethane use also in industry. There is also Brazil, which currently produces about 11 terawatt hours of biomethane and has a potential of about 60 terawatt hours by 2050. That's again a five-time increase. There's Argentina, which has a potential more than 100 terawatt hours. So you see there are a lot of large players out there. And if you take a very short look, I'm not a specialist of India. We have many colleagues here in the panel who can talk better, but in the moment, there's something like 0.5 terawatt hours of biomethane being produced. But you have this huge variety of small scale digesters for biogas, not biomethane, for biogas, something like 5 million or so. And you have heard about the massive resource base you have in terms of residues and waste to draw from and produce biomethane. From the IEA point of view and from my point of view as the director of a small institute working internationally, biomethane is the real connector from fossil to a renewable future. We surely have to talk about hydrogen, and hydrogen is also part of the renewable gas family, but from a cost point of view and from a compatibility point of view, hydrogen is second to biomethane. In the longer term, we may argue and we may come up with a hydrogen infrastructure, but in the near term, and in the middle term, biomethane is a key renewable gas option. And sustainability-wise, it's one of the best options we have from all biomass. So in that sense, it's versatile. It's cost, you may argue. And you may be aware about the situation we have in Europe nowadays, where natural gas is becoming an issue of security of supply. And that will boost even more than the greenhouse gas perspective, the near-term options for biomethane. The European Commission is currently talking about a biomethane target. And that's very important because that will allow a more secure investment perspective going beyond what we have seen already. And I think for India, it's very, very important to consider biomethane in the context of all renewable gases. It's not an either or, it's a go together. And in that sense, the Verbio presentation you just heard before about the combination of biomethane and hydrogen is an important perspective to overcome this competition thing. With that, I would like to stop my initial inputs. Thank you, Arthur.
Thank you, Uwe. Are there any questions from the panel to Uwe? No. Okay. So we heard before about the potential in India, and Uwe just mentioned it also. Can one of you guys give more details on what is happening today on biomethane production in India? Not necessarily from straw, but in general, how many plants are there? What's the volume? Is there anybody who could answer this question? Perhaps Ashish or Shivangi?
So, Arthur, hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Am I audible? Perfect. Arthur, India actually, in fact, in 2018, predominantly we have been a country which has used agricultural waste in a lot of energy production means. In fact, we have over 200 biogas units, biogas to power, bio-CNG units overall. In 2018, in fact, specifically, India launched the Satat scheme, which was for including bio-CNG in our transportation system. Wherein we had targeted that we will come up with about 5,000 plants for about 15 million metric tons, composition within our own energy mix. In fact, that is one of the ways India is trying to promote bio-CNG within the nation, which is actually not just by the subsidy schemes, but also by making it competitive. Making it lucrative enough for investors. There are guaranteed offtakes within the scheme. And over the last couple of years, we've actually seen about 3,200 LOIs being.
Shivangi, can you please adjust your microphone? We can't hear you.
In the nation, of which
Shivangi.
15
Shivangi.
Have actually been commissioned.
Shivangi, can you please adjust your microphone? We can't hear you. We lost her. I hope she's coming back. Too bad.
Yes, she has lost connection.
Okay.
Can I begin here instead of Shivangi until she comes back? Am I audible?
Perhaps in the meanwhile, Sam could give us some additional information.
Thanks, Arthur. Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning. So from our perspective, we are a Bangalore-based company. Our company is known as Carbon Masters. We have a brand called Carbon Lights. We've been at this for over about 5 years now. Started very small projects where we could. Our initial thought process was to use waste coming out of municipalities, food waste, convert them into two climate-friendly products, which is bottled bio-CNG and organic fertilizer, and displace both chemical fertilizers and fossil fuels such as LPG and diesel. Now, there's a lot happening on the ground. I think Satat has really put this on the map. it's a mainstream, it's all the positive things, you know, it's a mainstream consideration. Recently, we've just had our Prime Minister inaugurate, the largest plant, possibly the biggest plant in the Asia, which is going to process about 500 tons plus on a day-to-day basis. The market's been, India's had biogas, I think, like yoga, India has given biogas to the world. I mean, to some extent, largely because the first biogas plant was done in India. Just that the development of it has been largely to power. So if I come now, post-2010, we recognize that power is not viable, largely because of the other developments. From our point of view, power is not a good idea. It is bottling of gas and grid. You have huge opportunities to go and displace diesel and LPG. And when you have currently the market price where the oil is more than $100-$110 a barrel, and then also on the retail market, LPG is about 100 rupees plus, diesel is about close to 100. We don't really need any subsidy support in order to sell biomethane. But what is a bottleneck until now is how do you actually take the organic manure, which is in more quantity on a day-to-day basis, and convince farmers who've been heavily subsidized to use chemical fertilizers to switch over to adopt regenerative agriculture practices, because that's going to be the most important thing for any bio-CNG plant to succeed. So I would almost say that, we need to focus on the market deployment of biomethane, but also equally and more importantly, also focus on the organic fertilizer coming out of it. Now, I would say that India has been really looking to solve this problem, because we've also now recognized the liquid fertilizer, the digestate, as part of the FCO, which is the fertilizer control order. And we are able to now also put the product in front of farmers because it's now legal. So both solid and liquid need help in order to adopt and do a lot of field tests, etc., to convince farmers to move away from chemical fertilizers. That's my take on this.
All right. So, hey, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Sharad. I manage business development for renewable natural gas for Shell in the Asia region. I'll briefly talk about Shell's activity, and then I'll add to the market potential of biomethane beyond what some of my friends have already spoken about. So Shell has been in biomethane for decades now, and sometimes I find it difficult to track back all the work that's been done. In US, we are already running a plant in Oregon. It's a pretty large scale plant, almost 750,000 MMBtu per year. In Europe, we are already dispensing bio LNG, and we are further expanding our portfolio in Germany and Netherlands. In Europe, our target segment is decarbonization of heavy duty trucking, and then eventually getting to the marine segment. In India, we have been active for a few years now, very strong focus on building capabilities on each part of the value chain. So we have got some venture investments right up on the feedstock aggregator side. We have been doing a lot of work with some of the top technical institutes in India on understanding the yields from various feedstocks, etc. Doing work with EPCs and technology providers to understand the various technology options and how they fit. Of course, our own work on the safety standards, which are really important to fix in the Indian context, because cost versus safety is an ongoing debate. I fully agree that there's a huge potential for biogas in India. I mean, all the market fundamentals are in place. As I always say internally, here is a market where you can produce biogas at almost 1/4 to 1/6 the cost on a per unit energy basis compared to what you would see in Europe. Plus the prices that the end users are paying for the fossil equivalents today are pretty high. So I see that all the market fundamentals are in place, but I think we just need to add a few more elements to how we look at the opportunity. And I personally think that first and foremost, biogas in India serves three main purposes. First of all, the energy security purpose, a very, very strong focus on reducing India's dependence on import of fossil fuels. Second, which I think is the most important one, and so I know you and your team have been doing so much of work around this one, is more benefits to the farmer and the rural community in terms of the additional income that can come to the farmers because of feedstock valorization, etc. as well as some of the good fertilizers that need to really go back to that market. And then a third, of course, is the urban and rural pollution reduction. So I think if these are the three major foundations on which India is looking to build its biogas segment. Now, where is the value? Obviously, there is value for the project developers in terms of setting up the plants and making commercial returns out of it. There is immense value which is locked away on the fertilizer side, which as Soam talked about, because there is another program being launched to do a lot of natural farming on the banks of the river Ganga. And the fertilizer stream has not fully been valued yet. And finally, there is a benefit. Actually, I should have talking about as one of the biggest benefits. Rather than looking at biogas as a molecule which needs to be sold at a particular price, I see biogas as a significant solution for industrial and commercial decarbonization. I mean, with so many organizations today, almost everyone, and countries declaring their net zero ambitions. And I'm getting customers who are coming to us who about 3 years back said, hey, can we get biogas at a bit of a discount to the fossil fuels? Today, the same customers coming back and saying we are ready to pay quite a bit of premium because of it being a green fuel. So the right policy mechanisms can be enabled. I mean, our friends in Europe will know about the whole mass balance based approach or the book and claim approach that is being used. So that biogas, wherever it is produced in India, and we unfortunately cannot produce biogas exactly at the same point where the customer needs it. But if that transaction can be enabled so that consumers can access biogas physically or virtually through a paper-based transaction, I think there's a lot of value that can still be unlocked. Obviously, doing all of this needs very strong collaboration between various entities because there's just so many elements that I just talked about, and no organization can have all of these capabilities in their own kitty. So that's where collaboration between government, technical institutes, feedstock aggregators, engineering companies, startups, all becomes very, very important if you know the true value of biogas in India has to be realized in an accelerated way.
Thank you, Sharad. This brings me to another question which was raised several times. We heard it from Ashish that the first 100 plants needs a strong support, which means subsidies in one form or another. And Soam and yourself, you mentioned that it is self-supported because the difference between production of biomethane and the price of oil is large enough to cover the cost. What is the case now? May I ask Ashish if they have different approach? Or because in the opening session, we heard that there are quite a number of programs from the government. So I suppose you would profit from those programs.
Right, Arthur. I think from an initial support, we talked about, I think Shivangi mentioned about the SATAT program, which was launched in October 2018. It was definitely a starting point for the industry to take off. It was a very positive move and still continues to be one. I think everybody agrees that there is a strong market fundamental, there is a strong market potential which is there. But then why is it still not getting implemented? If everything is so strong and everything is, you know, so attractive, there must be a reason that we have 3,108, if I remember the number right, LOI signed. But how many of these letter of intents are actually getting translated into investments? So yes, there is an investment taking place, but not to the same nature as what one would have wanted. And there are reasons to it. And let's try and address these reasons in a very constructive manner. The first and strongest reason for a product like this to take off is the pricing. The pricing the end user pays for CNG or CBG today is at least about 30% lower than the alternate fuel. Now, that's a fantastic situation from a market point of view. You have an end consumer who will switch from a diesel or petrol to a CNG or a CBG because of the price argument. So there is an end consumer, a willing end consumer, which is existing. Then So where comes the challenge? The challenge comes the supply. The supply infrastructure needs to be erected, which means the investments need to be brought in. And that is where I try to highlight, gave you an overview of what are the topics which need to be addressed by the policymaker in a kind of a second round of policies. And one of the strongest things, but what you know, one has to acknowledge is we do not want this sector to emerge as a small scale industry. It's not a small scale industry. It needs to be respected or needs to have a status of any large scale industry, right? So when it comes to financial assistance, it is needed. The government needs to give the right message out. We had a central financial assistance to these projects, which was recently withdrawn. Now, that's, I would say, a negative message, and particularly for the small or mid-sized investors. It definitely impacts. That is one. The second thing, which is very, very critical, especially for the mid or large scale investments, is getting low cost financing. I think we did talk about a lot of funds and schemes which are present at a global level or by EU, but we still talk about the cost of capital at anything about 8 to 10%. Now that, with all these uncertainties in the business case, what we have today, where the offtake of manure is not assured, this leads to a not a very comfortable business case. So we need low-cost financing. We need to tap the financial institutions, the international ones, World Bank, ADB, KfW, to really make sure that we are getting low-cost financing, getting implemented to erect these projects. So this is why I mentioned about the financial support, wherein the government could really play a significant role. Then comes, there was a question regarding this round and square bales. We need to understand that there is a huge demand to automate this complete supply chain. None of these machinery are actually locally manufactured in India, or the ones which are actually locally manufactured, they really are at a very low tech, a low scale level. So all these machinery needs to be imported, right? And so again, it becomes an investment. This comes at an import duty, there are taxes. So it's a significant part of the investment. About, I would say roughly about 8 to 10% of the investment goes into these machinery. So here we have been making a representation that when the government is willing to subsidize these machinery for the farmers, why not to the industry? We are solving the same purpose. So there is clearly a case wherein the government could also support, subsidizing the purchase of this straw collection machinery. Then my fellow colleague did talk about the biomanure topic. This is definitely one of the key things which needs to be addressed yesterday. For a plant like ours, we will produce on full capacity more than 500 tons of biomanure per day. Like we have a very strong offtake agreement with our partner Indian Oil, the same kind of an offtake needs to be organized for the biomanure as well. You can imagine the kind of storage space which is needed to take care of this daily volume. So we need a offtake mechanism. We need a pricing, price security mechanism. There have been discussions to introduce a subsidy of, let's say, roughly about 1.5 rupees per kilogram of this biomanure, keeping it equivalent to the city compost level. But we are yet to see it getting formalized. So biomanure is going to be another topic over here. Then, I can talk about, how we can further optimize our commercial arrangement with the offtaker. I must say that the oil marketing companies have been extremely supportive. We get excellent cooperation from Indian Oil. But I still see that there are certain levers which can still be improved. For example, we still have offtake assurances and not guarantees, right? And for one plant, for this unit, what we have, I think we are quite safe, we are quite secure. But if we have to think of raising finances, the banks will ask for such kind of agreements. How do we make our agreements more bankable? right? So we need to address these kind of topics. And finally, one of the additional areas where significant investments gets locked, almost 4 to 5%, is in the transportation of gas. Yes, we are using bottles to fill up over here, because the grid connectivity is not the most, let's say, widespread, and it is not penetrating across India. So till such time that such kind of grid connectivity is enabled, we need to also look at how can the investment into these prime movers as well as cascades can be supported. So it's probably a long answer to what you asked, but I just am trying to highlight that, yes, there is a strong market case. There is enough potential in the market. We are already invested in the market, and I'm talking purely based on the ground level experience what we have. We are not at a letter of intent stage. We have invested at the ground. We are implementing it. So all these things, what I'm talking about, is coming from live experience over here, right? So we are raising these topics because we are eager to get started with the next round of investment. And we would really look forward to these, you know, all these topics what we just discussed getting addressed in a, you know, we need to have solutions. We need to really come out with the right market mechanisms so that the investment case becomes bankable. It really needs to have a sustainable character, which at the moment is a bit shaky.
Thank you, Ashish. I mean, India is not unique in having problems with the bankability. It's the same in Europe in a different level, but bankability is really one of the major discussion points. But I would like to ask Shivangi, I think she is among us again, whether they have knowledge about future programs which could help the situation for Kumar or everybody else to get off the ground. Shivangi, we can't hear you. Shivangi. No, sorry.
Am I audible?
Yeah, it's great now. Yeah. Did you hear my question? Whether there are any programs in planification to fulfill the wishes of Verbio and others?
Shivangi, you're muted. You have to unmute and talk.
No, I had unmuted myself. I think there are certain Wi-Fi issues with our system.
Now we can hear. Now we can hear. You can answer the question that he has been asked.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. So, Arthur, I actually heard a lot of points that were made till now around, you know, the challenges that the industry, and that is, in fact,
we can't hear you.
The issues have been multifold around financing as well as offtake of biomanures, as highlighted by Mr. Ashish. However, I would like to actually, you know, take a step here and, you know, make people aware that our central banks, such as SBI, PNB, Canara, etc., have in fact taken out bio-CNG specific financing schemes, which could definitely do better than where they are right now. But this is something that a lot of the public sector banks have taken up for specifically financing bio-CNG projects. In fact, at the ministry level, there's been a very severe representation around offtakes of biomanure as well, wherein there are close cooperations going on with NAFED and IFCO to look at establishments and mechanisms that we can establish for offtake of these byproducts. And these points are very well received. In fact, you know, they are something that the ministry is at this point of time deliberating on so as to fasten up the speed at which the projects are being deployed. There are state level committees that have been established at various districts within the nation in order to reduce the gaps that are there between the investors as well as on-ground establishment of these units. So points well received from the different players, but I'm mentioning they are something that the government is definitely trying to address. At the same time, we see there's a huge market push from with private sector entrants, in fact, coming up at different levels within the whole value chain. So from biomass aggregators to even, equipment manufacturers, we see a lot of the private players entering each and every aspect within the value chain, which the government is, in fact, trying to promote.
Okay. I hope this helps, because without reasonable low cost money, there is no development. That's a fact all over the world. So every country needs an own solution, but bankability is crucial. I would like to raise another question, which I heard among the talks or inputs, which is the fertilizer at the end. Obviously, this is a decisive point. If you can't handle and sell or distribute the fertilizer, you cannot manage the projects. I'm wondering. We heard from Verbio that they are aware of that, and we heard also from some that they are aware of it, but. Do you have any solutions? Are there programs to convince farmers? Are they educational programs within agriculture? Or what is the direction to go that way?
So, Arthur, I'll come from what we are doing currently. So we are working with, farmers directly. We've tried working with the chemical fertilizer dealers. It's been a challenge. It's been a challenge because they don't normally sell chemical fertilizers. It just moves. Whereas with organic fertilizer, you need a program. You need to, the good news is that farmers need this. Most, at least the farmers that we are interacting, there's been a shift. There's been awareness. They all know. They all apply some level of cow dung, manure, etc. But here, the point is, we need to raise awareness that this is more than just solving India's biomethane problem, right? Or, the market deployment around the biofuels. The soils have completely been depleted. So what we are doing is we are holding a lot of awareness sessions with group of farmers anywhere ranging between 50 to 100 and conducting sessions, doing field trials in order to deploy the produce that we are currently generating in both two states across Karnataka and Telangana. We have excellent support also from the government. I wouldn't say that we've not had any support at all. But the procurement of like what my other friends have been pointing out is very important. The scales that we are not venturing. I mean, with Verbios, they've actually gone ahead and put in such a huge facility. We are not doing it largely because we're not sure that we can actually liquidate so much amount of organic manure on a day-to-day basis. You know, 500 tons is not a joke. It requires handholding. It requires, and there is a role for government to play here, without which this will not happen. But right now, for the volumes we are producing with the amount of demand out there. Each year, we are learning some more. We have started working with the fertilizer producer organizations, which are FPOs. We are directly working with farmers, large estate owners, tea estates, etc. So we are able to liquidate the amount of fertilizer that we are producing. But it for quantities which are huge, we will require support.
Perhaps a question to Ashish to continue the discussion. You said you want to reach compost quality with your with your digestate, which is a fair approach. But has compost a relatively good renommé in India, or is it also a problem?
So, Arthur, in fact, as Som mentioned, we have also been in touch with the local farmers around us. And there is receptiveness. They are open to trying it. But yes, it's not really a first time for them, because as was mentioned, that they're familiar with this organic manure concept. They already use in certain form, right? But it is largely dominated by chemical-based fertilizers, which will continue. So what we see over here in terms of, let's say, the first positive step which came from the government side was the amendments which were made to the fertilizer control order in the last 2 years, wherein the fermented organic manure was accepted. It was acknowledged that, okay, these are the set compositions which we need to comply to, and then yes, it is a saleable product. So from a policy point of view, that has been introduced by the central government. Now we need to take the next step, wherein it needs to be implemented. The policy needs to be implemented at a state level. So a direct communication interface with the farmer, yes, we need it, but probably that is going to solve maybe 20-30% of our volume. We are talking, when we talk about large scale volumes, there we need a kind of an offtake agreement, as to my understanding, like the way we have with Indian Oil for the gas. Similarly, the large fertilizer companies should have an obligation to offtake certain volumes, right? Because when we talk about small scale, then yes, you can you can manage it within a radius of, let's say, 20-30 kilometers. It should work normally. So I would expect that there will be three ways to handle the volume we are looking at. One, it goes back to the farmer from where the feedstock is getting collected, right? So it's a kind of giving back the same nutritional value what we have taken from them in the form of, you know, the straw. The second, and the bulk of this volume, needs to be addressed to these large fertilizer companies who, by the way, have, you know, certain organic product also in their portfolio. So, I mean, these are large, you know, companies. They can clearly address the kind of volumes we are looking at. And the third stream would be to maybe, you know, directly retail it on our own. We are looking at direct retailing, bagging them and directly retailing them. Ultimately, we have to address the volume what we are generating. It cannot be stored. So it needs to be addressed. And we are looking at a market, let's say, which is in a radius of up to 200, 250 kilometers. Because the longer we go, the more expensive the product becomes. So it needs to be localized in some sense over here. So initial good support from the central government. Right now, we are discussing at a state level. We get good support also from the Agriculture University. We are in touch with the Agriculture University over a joint project, wherein the effectiveness of this product will be seen across all the crops of Punjab. But it's a long exercise. They definitely need minimum two cycles to really establish any kind of concrete conclusions. Long exercise means we are talking about up to 2 years. So there is a bit of uncertainty around how the biomanure is actually going to be managed at the ground level.
Yeah, another quick point that I wanted to make here was, I mean, currently India spends about $85 billion in subsidizing chemical fertilizers, right? So urea, they're purchasing at 17, 18 rupees and supplying it to the farmer at 6 rupees. Why are we not doing that? I mean, no, here we could actually, I mean, the other thing to point out is all the chemical fertilizers, you know, they can coexist. We don't want to start an organic farming movement, right? We're not going to position ourselves. We are talking about soil health. We're talking about, for effective utilization of chemical fertilizers, you need a better soil, good soil health. And right now, it's less than 1%. Most regions that we are working, the soil organic carbon is around 0.5 to 0.1, I mean, 1%. That's not the place to be. And, you know, you're looking at desertification. I mean, there's a very good movie on Netflix, actually. There's a documentary, Kiss the Ground. I think this is one thing that we should really all watch. It'll show you that we are not left with too many harvests. It's probably 40 or 60 harvests. It's very scary. There is more happening below the ground than above the ground. I mean, you know, on both in terms of carbon emissions, soil health, agriculture, There are movements in the US now which are talking about paying the farmer to add organic manure. Which there's a company called Indigo Carbon who are working on it, where the farmer doesn't have to pay. I mean, you know, and when basically they, you can sequester carbon and then make that as carbon credits and then trade it and therefore make that whole thing viable. So I think there's various ways to make this work. Like rightly Ashish said, you know, the same people who are supplying straw can also, you know, help the organic manure to go back to the soil and make this as a circular economy model. And they're part of the whole ecosystem where they supply feedstock and also are captive consumers of organic fertilizer. We just need to put mechanisms in place and give a clear indication of how to make this happen.
Okay. Are there any other points from the panelists they would want to raise now?
Yeah, so I look at the biogas market in India in three segments. One is the very large scale, commercial scale plants. And majority of our discussion so far has been around it. And I fully agree with the views that the panelists have put. And the only thing I can say again and again and again is we need a market for biogas as a decarbonization solution. Otherwise, we'll always be chasing policymakers to keep increasing the offtake price, which at one point will get saturated out. Now let's talk about the other two segments. There is a really small scale segment, and one of the panelists shared the statistic of almost 5 million biogas plants being already up and running in India, which are really micro scale. So that is the scale at which we can never expect commercial viability. But there's a lot of interest that is coming from folks chasing carbon credits. And from what I hear, there's a lot of funding going towards those projects to implement more and more, and the monetization is done through the carbon credit space. And I think that's another space where a lot of international collaboration can happen. There are a lot of good organizations in India who are doing really good ground level work, but they're more in the CSR or developmental kind of space. Then there's a middle segment, which is where I would say, which is about, let's say, 10 to 50 tons of feedstock input per day. So these use cases are usually around, let's say, a food park or a food processing industry, where on an opportunistic basis, there is waste available, clean waste available. But a commercial scale, standalone commercially viable biogas plant is not fully viable. So there are some companies who are just doing it as an in-house initiative to make that biogas and replace a part of in-house LPG replace from that biogas. And I think finally, biogas in India, let's recognize, will need to be a decentralized solution given the expanse of India, given the way feedstock, different types of feedstocks are spread across the country. The business models will need to be fit for the course. While there'll be several good opportunities for very large scale plants, but finally the micro scale plants and the mid scale plants will have their own place as the market fully develops. And on the medium segment, my take is that if the right incentives can be given to the organizations who deploy such solutions. So like we had the REC mechanism in India, sorry, the RPO mechanism in India to procure renewable power. If some of these incentives or some of those biogas, which is going in either as a mandate or as an incentive to these industrial and commercial unit comes in, then there'll be a lot more acceleration in the medium segment of the market also. So I'd say whenever we paint the picture of biogas in India, of course, it's important to talk about the very large scale plants, but then the micro scale and the medium scale plants also have got a lot of value for the society, for the business. And we need to keep talking about what can be done to accelerate those two segments.
Yeah, I certainly agree to that. I would have another question getting away from the fertilizer quality. Shell has the strategy of Shell in the recent 2 years is making collaborations with producers of biogas primarily, and making new companies. Shell is selling the biomethane, and the other company usually is producing it. Are there any targets in India on that, like they do it in Europe and in the US particularly? I would see a big opportunity, as just out of my belly, a big opportunity to collaborate with Verbio. I mean, they have produced these trucks, but primarily they're producers. So a collaboration would make sense to me from seen from very far. So what is your ideas about that?
So absolutely, Arthur. I think, as I said, when I spoke initially, that there is so much to be done in this segment that no one organization can have all the capabilities. So collaboration is going to be critical. Now, on your initial point, Arthur, so we, in US, we already have our own plant, and we also, so we own a plant in Oregon, and we sell gas from that, and we're building more plants. In Europe also, you're right, right now there's a lot of bio-LNG, which is based on biogas from third party, which we're selling. But in Nordsol facility, we have got equity, which has then its own biogas. Plus, we are looking at own biogas facilities in Europe also. In India, we are very aggressively pursuing opportunities to set up our own plants. So we have been in discussions with several organizations in different parts of the country based on different feedstocks. But in the right opportunity, we are open to, you know, a partnership where one partner looks at one part of the value chain and we look at another part of the value chain. Some of those discussions are already ongoing on various sites, biogas site, fertilizer site, carbon credit site. But I mean, if anybody from the panel, from the audience wants to pick up that discussion further, please reach out. I'll be very, very happy to have those conversations.
Ashish, did you have discussions in the direction of collaboration with other companies?
So Arthur, we are also evaluating different collaborative opportunities because, as you rightly pointed out, there are so many cogs to this whole situation. So it is almost impossible to do everything on your own. So you ultimately need to have a collaborative approach. So we are evaluating different cooperation models in India as well. So to answer you, yes, we are doing that. And I'll also probably want to get back to what was just mentioned. The topic is, it's like any other industry. It's not only comprised of large investors or players. They're going to be small, they're going to be mid-sized, they're going to be large guys, right? So, it's all relative, it's all contextual. Today, we might think 33 TPD is large, but I think with the kind of feedstock we generate, you can set up a 100 TPD plant, and believe me, the entire thing can get consumed in a radius of, let's say, 50 kilometers. That is the kind of feedstock and the opportunity we are talking about. So we need to get the size in the right context over here. If we are going too small, and too small means anything which is, let's say, less than 2 TPD kind of a facility, honestly, I don't know what is the kind of economic viability of that business case. How long can it really survive or with that kind of, you know, dynamics? Or even if it survives, what is the magnitude of problem it is solving? Right? I mean, we are talking about huge, you know, millions and millions of tons of straw getting burnt and, you know, feedstock available around us. Yes, you need a mushrooming concept, but let the mushrooms not be so small that it becomes, you know, super complicated to even manage that ecosystem. So we need to address the issue of size a little bit more, carefully, that below a certain segment, do we really want to encourage that? I'm not saying the right is 30 or 20, maybe the right is 5, or it could be 7, or it could be 10, right? We need to really address that part. So, so that's my take. I mean, and yes, when you're dealing with such kind of scale, it is not possible to do it on our own. Today, we have an excellent cooperation with Indian Oil. Whether we talk about gas, whether we talk about anything related to even the offtake of manure, it is, we are trying to find solutions together with Indian Oil, though it's an oil marketing company, but they have been very supportive in trying, you know, to help us with this manure topic as well. So we are looking at collaborative opportunities in India. Yeah.
Arthur, sorry to interrupt you, Kyriakos here. There are several questions from the attendees.
So if you would agree, perhaps we should address some of them before we go back to the panelists for the closing remarks, because there are about maybe 10 questions.
Yes, Kyriakos, that's exactly what I wanted to do. I saw that there are plenty of questions, so please go ahead.
Excellent. Ernesto, are you ready to put the first one? Ernesto? Yeah. Who can take this one? Arthur, maybe you guide who should answer this question.
Okay, but is this the first question or the one we had before?
Well, let's take this one. Let's go with the sequence that we see on the screen.
Okay. Well, probably it's addressed to Verbio, I assume.
Okay. Can I have the question back on? Okay, so we start with this one. What made you decide to develop? So the answer is simple. We could not get any third party who could deliver the feedstock at the quality and the cost what we were looking at. And by quality, I mean moisture, the moisture of the feedstock. I mean, as we all know, paddy is a moisture-rich crop, and the kind of moisture level of the feedstock we found available in the market was almost, let's say, more than 30-35% plus. And that is something which does not work as far as our production process is concerned. We are looking at a moisture of less than 20%. So that is one. Second is a question of cost. We did try a third-party solution for the feedstock as well, but the kind of costing we were looking at, that did not really make a sound case for us. And that's why we did it on our own.
Okay, Ernesto, the next one, please. This is an important question as far as the complete biogas, biomethane area is concerned.
Yes, we heard that several times, so I don't know who wants to answer first. It has been mentioned by at least three panelists, by Sharad, by some, and by Ashish. So who wants to take the answer?
Maybe if you allow me, Arthur, just a more global view. First of all, it's important to say if there is a residue waste feedstock for the biogas and biomethane, we typically see from something like 100 studies and case and measurements and so forth, that there is a very low greenhouse gas balance that includes the methane losses from the biogas plant. But to establish that, the discussion about the fertilizer is quite important. I think that's really a significant part of the game, is to offset, to substitute fossil-based fertilizers, synthetic fertilizers. That brings the balance into the right direction, let's say. The other is that if you go to the transport market and you're talking about compressed natural gas, bio-CNG, you need to consider the emissions, the leakage and slippage from the compression system. And that is something which is in the order of 2 to 4 and sometimes 5%. And there we need more work. I think that's something where standardization should improve, that we should go in a direction of 2%, and then we have a much better greenhouse gas balance compared to petrol or diesel. So I think this is what we know in the moment. We have measurements to substantiate that. And in terms of, again, of the fertilizers, this is a major component in the low greenhouse gas balance. So without a fertilizer component from the digester, the balance would not be that positive. Thank you.
Thank you, Wei. I think the question also mentioned the air quality, if I'm not wrong. So I think that is probably in India a very urgent case, as we have seen in the introduction. So are there any programs on that that could be very supportive? Shivangi could perhaps tell us whether there are programs, or Ashish, I mean, whoever knows.
So, Arthur, in fact, there is a commission which has been set up. There's a commission for air quality monitoring. And I think they are really trying to do some good work to really bring this situation under control. So I would say from a government side, as far as the priority is concerned to really address this problem is very strong at the moment at the central. And that is probably the reason why this commission has been set up. I hope this is really going to turn out to incentivizing companies to invest in trying to find a solution.
I would also actually like to add in that, I mean, as Mr. Ashish mentioned, there are commissions that have been, you know, committees that have been formulated. There are also indirect mechanisms that have been put into place. For example, recently in our budget, it was decided that in order to promote, you know, improved air quality and in order to reduce the stubble burning, etc., activities happening around, we have started, in fact, penalizing unblended fuel, as well as looking at promoting blended fuels within the economy. Even the thermal power plants have been given a certain mandate of 5 to 7 biomass, aggregation and blending for their power plant units. So we also expect that as the whole industry matures, starting from the biomass aggregation to the biofuel construction, the way the government is trying to promote the whole air quality monitoring as well as reduction of pollution out there is essentially by promoting industries and industrial players to take on creating businesses out of the waste management opportunities in these areas.
Ernesto, there was a question from Iron PI. Can we go to the question from Iron PI from Sumitomo Corporation about the 2G RNG? And then I see that Sivanji wants to give a response.
Sure. So as of now, we do not have any guidelines around differential pricing for 2G versus 1G fuels. One of the main rationales that we've heard around that is essentially the lack of any basis that exists because of the lack of, commercial deployments that have happened on 2G biogas productions. Even for 2G bioethanol, which was there in parallel, governments looked at creating financial assistance being available for those units. But pricing is something that I think we can expect a bit more, guidelines around that once a few units start getting deployed. So that is an area that I wanted to clarify. We can look up, we might look at having CFA's financial assistance on advanced biofuels. But as of now, the pricing is debatable due to the lack of benchmarks.
There is another question. Yeah.
Do you think that in the future, straw will be considered as fuel? So can I address this? So the feedstock what we are talking about in our context is paddy. Paddy is not used as fodder, and there are reasons for that because of the high silica content it has. So that is why it is not suitable for even the animal consumption. So as far as paddy is concerned, the answer is no. It is not used as fodder. But when we talk about any other form of feedstock, whether it is wheat straw, yes, that is used as fodder. That is the reason why it comes at a higher cost, right? But it does definitely help in kind of de-risking the supply chain because paddy comes once in a year during the month of October, November, and we need to collect it and store it for the complete year. So there is a risk associated to the storage and protection of the feedstock for a period of 10 months. And that's why if there is an additional feedstock possibility, it just helps to de-risk the supply chain.
Ernesto, then can we move to the question from David Caramonte?
Who I missed half of the question. I couldn't see who should answer.
Yeah, Ernesto, put it back, please. Don't take it out. Leave it on the screen. Ernesto, can you please place back the question from David Chiaramonti? Okay, till Ernesto will be able to manage that, then I will make some questions directly because they are in the chat and not in the Q&A. There is one question from Mr. Ramakrishna. And the question is the following. What about CO2 valorization? This could be another important source of revenue.
Hi. I think, is it about CO2 bottling and selling it? Is that the question? Bottling of CO2?
Valorization of CO2.
Can't hear. Hello?
The question is, what about carbon dioxide valorization? This could be another important source of revenue. Okay. Mr. Ramakrishna, maybe you can place it directly.
Well, you know, bottling and selling CO2 is one part of it. CO2 can also be converted into many other useful products, including energy. When you have renewable hydrogen, you know, you can combine renewable hydrogen with CO2 to get ethanol, methanol, whatever it is. So there are various such possibilities. If you don't do the valorization at this point of time, then we are letting all the CO2 back into the atmosphere. So if you have a target of 15 million metric tons of CVG to be produced, we are talking about almost 8 to 10 million metric tons of CO2 being released into the atmosphere. So we need to capture it and convert that into useful product.
Absolutely. I think, you know, we have also, what we do in our factories is that we bottle CNG, bio-CNG, and sell it as a replacement for LPG. A lot of industries, when we are discussing, they are also using CO2, right? And the price is not as much as, for biomethane, but it's definitely in the range of, we've even gathered data of 20, 30 rupees. And there's an existing ecosystem because the CO2 is being supplied to these industries for various purposes. So, it can be very low as well. We've not really gone into that level of detail, but largely because there's no solution right now for us from a technology point of view where we can actually bottle, extract CO2 and put it out in the market.
There is another question from Professor Geeta Vaidyanathan to assist. And the question is, if you are looking at 250 kilometer radius to distribute your biomanure, could you share the radius of feedstock procurement?
Sorry, could you say the last part again?
If you are looking for 250 kilometer radius to distribute the biomanure, could you share the radius of feedstock procurement? I mean, what is the radius from around which you collect the feedstock?
So the feedstock, what we need annually, as I said, 100,000 tons, we are able to collect it within a radius of 10 kilometers. We are surrounded by farms. There is nothing else around the capacity. But to bring the manure back into the same 10 kilometers is not possible. That means there has to be a complete substitution of their existing fertilizer practice by this manure, which will not happen. So that's why we need to travel the distance. And yes, we are today looking at a radius of up to 200 or 250 kilometers, wherein this manure could be sold.
Okay, Ernesto, now can we have the question from David Chiaramonti? Arthur, maybe you can guide the question to the right panelist.
Yes, I would reading the question, I would suggest that we give the floor for a second to David to pronounce the question more clearly, if that is possible.
I think that would be complicated.
Okay, then let's, okay.
Yeah, perhaps if Klaus is still with us, if Klaus could try to answer it. Can we see again the question, Ernesto, please? Klaus, are you still with us?
Well, I can try to distribute the answer. So the question is, yes, here we got it. It's about sequestration. I mean, honestly, in Europe, we don't know too much about sequestration. We know the places with poor soils, depleted soils, where sequestration is outstanding, as Poppy several times highlighted in their publications. But for the richer soils, we don't know exactly what the effect of sequestration is. There are, of course, in northern Italy, a lot of experiments which are rather positive. But on the other hand, we have very rich soils in southern Germany and in Switzerland where the sequestration has no big effect. So my question would then be to specify this a little bit. Are there experience on sequestration in India? Who could answer that?
Arthur, if you allow me, I think the discussion here is quite important because it's not just the carbon. When we talk about the greenhouse gas balance of organic substance coming into the soils, as you rightly pointed out, it depends on the soil characteristics. We know that there is a short-term effect regarding N2O, and we know that lignin remains quite stable. And there's also the debate, which I think David could elaborate if he has time, to say that we could convert the digestate into biochar and get it into a very stable situation, whatever the soil is. But all of that is part of the overall issue: who is going to pay for that? Is there a value in sequestration? And that is something where Europe in the moment is trying to set up a carbon farming scheme, which actually supports farmers financially. And in the United States, we have discussions around giving credit to the farmers, carbon credits, so that they can valorize it on the markets. So there is some dynamic. And I think it's very important to consider that if we talk about real deployment, especially in India, because given the soil characteristics you have, at least in some parts of the country, we would have a huge benefit. But now David is there, so happy to
have David, very short, because we're approaching the time. I would like that Arthur takes back the time to close the discussion.
Okay, so now very quickly, I mean, I fully agree with Uwe. You already said part of my thoughts. The point is that if we talk about carbon sequestration, there are two forms. One is short and the other is long-lived. And I think we should focus on the long-lived, because otherwise it will be easily criticized that this carbon will go back to the atmosphere. That means to stabilize this. Is the argument instead is to make soil more fertile, more healthy, then labile carbon is working very well. Manure is an example, and many other possibilities. And the two things are not in competition, but are complementary. Of course, if CO2 credits is our target to monetize this action, you need long-lived carbon sequestration. And the Commission and the European Union is working in this direction. I don't want to take your time on that, but there are ongoing discussion, initiatives, and in the implementing act of RED II, there will be a differentiation, if everything goes as it is today, to distinguish between different forms of carbon farming. So we should not make a single basket of everything, must start to distinguish the duration of this carbon sequestration. That was my point.
Thanks, David. Arthur, we have back the floor for the last minutes of your discussion, of your panel.
Okay, I make it very short. Thank you all the panelists for the fantastic discussion and honest inputs. I thought it was a great exchange. I just have a final idea on the opening session. I learned from Maria that there is this India EU-India cooperation. But what I learned, I mean, this is an old story, but what I learned that only 8 projects on energy, but none on biofuels or biomethane. So just as my last input, if you get connected among each other, think about taking a chance and having such a project together with the EU. Would be great. Would be a great outcome of this discussion. Thank you very much.
Arthur, this was an excellent way to close the session, to the panel discussion. And we really look forward to have, I would say, more proposals coming from joint proposals from European and Indian organizations. And of course, biomethane, we see it has been a very hot topic. I mean, so far it is the panel discussion with the longest discussion, the most questions, which shows how important the subject and the topic is in both geographical areas and beyond. It's not only European and Indian, it's global. So yes, let's see. I mean, you are all the industry, key industry players. You are here present. Work together to come up with good proposals in the next questions of the European Commission, as Maria Yuriado showed yesterday. With that, again, I would like to thank Arthur for the excellent management. And I would like to thank all the panelists for the very, I would say, good and, as Arthur said, sincere answers, because it is not so, always so easy. With that, I close this, I would say, session on the deployment of biomethane. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We're moving to the next session, that is the commercialization of cellulosic ethanol. And there we start the session by having 2 keynote presentations. The first one is from Rehman Faizur. He is the head of Bio2X Fortum India. The title of the presentation is going to be biomass to biofuels.
Riakos, we should go to the next session technically. I have to close this.
Sorry.
People should join the next one on the schedule button. Please, see you later.
See you.